So when we started Plenary, I actually had another plan for this talk, but I realized that actually what I'm going to present would be the most related thing and perhaps interesting to the format Plenary. But it's more from my engineering hat, and it's about kind of bridging what I did during my PhD with what we're doing in Flucoma. And it's about Flucoma, but not about the toolbox that we'll see you later today, but it's more about thinking about a future toolbox or something that may happen in the future in the project. Right, so it's about from fluid to fluid, meaning from free sound to fluid sound. I have this presentation about free sound which I reused like 100 times. And I have the impression that most people who care about sound know quite well about free sound. So I'll try to not spend too much time on this. So basically, I did my PhD in the Music Technology Group and was invited to participate in this free sound project. Well, the thing is how the funding, and it's a big group, so people are kind of lumped together into this kind of hopeful projects. And I'm here, I don't put on my hand a kind of an interesting kind of participatory experience related to music and sound, because it's basically people uploading sounds on the website and all the things you can do with this kind of collaborative setting. And then on the other hand, how to deal with a large quantity of sounds using signal processing, which is kind of what is an experience that may be of interest for the goal. So freesound.org is a website. It started in 2005. It has more than 300,000 sounds. A small number of active users at the time normally, but overall like millions of registered users. You can do like most things you can do on a social media kind of site. So it was a bit like, at the time it was a bit like the Flickr of sounds. So you can geotag, you can command and rate and stuff like that. And very importantly, there's an emphasis on that on the text description, because that is what allows people to actually find sounds. So people are requested to describe properly their sounds that they upload, and using these kind of tags. But there's no other constraint, so it results in a kind of very, very diverse folksonomy of sounds. And it's really strange. It's very difficult to deal with it, because you always get something unexpected from it. And then, yeah, it has Creative Commons licenses. And then the infrastructure that runs it is it's a bit like, you know, we've been seeing people doing backspatches that do sound databases these days. And this is kind of the industrial version of it. So it's a website with lots of concurrent users, so it's hosted in a virtual machine with lots of processors and stuff like that and memory. But you know, time changes and our machines are every day faster and bigger, so we can pick some of the things actually and make use of them. And that's kind of the next that I'm trying to present. So mainly there's a text search server, there's Essentia, which Daniel mentioned yesterday, is a signal analysis library that has lots of descriptors. And then there's Gaia, which is a kind of similarity search server or kind of descriptor search server, something like that. And then, I just spoke about Essentia. I think the actual partition of the main groups of descriptors, I think, has changed a little bit. But most of them were developed for polyphonic music, and they used in free sound, but it's a bit of a mismatch sometimes, because a lot of songs don't have these musical qualities that we describe. But there are plenty of low-level descriptors as well, and these sound effects also sometimes work. Then, as I just mentioned, Gaia is kind of a C++ library for doing this kind of similarity server or for doing range queries. It doesn't have any particular algorithm for that. I think it's quite brute force, but it's in C++, it's quite fast. It's optimized as far as I know. And also it's convenient because it has many other features, like it does PCA, it does have the object model for dealing with these kind of things. Historically, these things and I were closed source for a long time, and then at some point they were open source. I had to do with the relationship with a company that had an exclusive license to those. And now they're available on the FairGPL. FreeSound makes interaction with these available through web APIs. I think I don't need to spend much time with this, but if you know about remote procedure calls, stuff like that, so how would you make a call from one computer, one program on one computer, to another program on another computer? Nowadays, you'll use a web API for all the most popular social media sites. Normally, you require some kind of identification or token that you can get from FreeSound. And there are clients for different languages. I did several of them, and particularly I did the Quark for SuperCollider that I'll present later. And then, well, I think I skipped a bit of this. You can do a text search, you can do filters based on different features of the site. And you can do content-based search based on descriptors. Mainly you can do either a target search, where you ask for something that is closest to these values of these descriptors. So the pitch is 400 Hertz. What's the closest to that in order? Or you can do range square, where you say, okay, which should be between 400 and 500, give me what's in between, and you can combine both. You can say, well, the pitch salience should be larger than 0.5, so the sound is pitch, and the pitch should be closest to 400. Right? But sometimes, apart from pitch, and as you mentioned yesterday, apart from a few descriptors that are useful, many of them are not very intuitive. So that's sometimes it's too abstract in this kind of interaction. It's much more easier to use an example, to have a sound and say, give me sounds like this sound. So this similarity, which also uses the target, so it analyzes one sound, it gets all the descriptors and finds other sounds that are closest to this target. It's a very useful feature of the site in general, and I think it's a very intuitive way to use this technology. And I think at the beginning, the first thing you mentioned about querying with your POC voice. So that's something I did some time ago. It was actually a quite popular topic in research, because this query I'm having for music, where you sing a melody and then you hope to retrieve melodies, song that has this melody. And then for sound, people started to think about the same kind of interaction, making weird sounds, thinking about how to map your what you can do with your voice to actually the wider spectrum of sounds. Anyway, we didn't try to do anything new. We just found that the moment that since it was open source, we could have the same program running in FreeSound, analyzing the sounds, and your machine analyzing your sounds. And therefore, it was really very easy to implement this kind of feature. And then it's basically a little Python server that does very simple analysis. RCC is derivative as well, so it has a bit of a temporal function. And then you record something with the browser, it goes to this server if you have your machine, it goes to FreeSound, it fetches some results. And actually, I can give you a tiny demo. It's a bit fragile because since they left the place, it used to be online there, but if I don't maintain it personally, then it just goes down. But I can run it in my machine, it still works. So let's try. I'll say something stupid. Sometimes it breaks because there's some text issue, not related to it, so it's a bug, so it will happen, but don't worry about it.
After many reasons.
So this just spoke out because just made now, some speech.
The FreeSound project is
right.
Produced the sound.
And that's like we sound. That's very useful.
Is that just looking through samples on your machine right now, or on?
No, it's on the more than 300,000 sounds. Yeah. It's finding the closest to my noise, so I can do that. Yes. Right. And
is there any accounting for times?
There is so this is statistic of MSCs and the derivative of MSCs.
So it's actually a static throughout.
It's just, you know, how fast it is changing over one frame. So there's no modeling of the time series at all.
Okay.
It's a problem that, you know, I think everyone thinks about. My whole PhD I was worried about this, but it's a complicated problem, especially when you have so much diversity. When you have music, you can do kind of more clever models, I would say, but for this it's really complicated. You can see. Every song has different, it's cut by a different person. So, of course, there's nothing stopping us from using this as well in studio with songs that are not vocal. And so this is something that, actually I hope that it will be incorporated into free song interface, but I think for the moment it's not being done. Some quarks or from SuperCollider, you can access this kind of API as well. I'll just skip a bit because I think I'll run out of time. So the main functionality is this: you can get some search for to the text search, the quantum search as a square. There's a combined search. It's a kind of complicated problem actually. You can combine text and descriptors. It's complicated from the server side. And actually, for a moment, I want to try it. And you can get the description for a given song, or you can get similar songs to a given song. And when I did a very well, this presentation I will have to talk with a talk I gave at Creative Coding Lab. And I tried to show it to kind of a live coding, and it didn't work very well. So this night, last night, I hacked kind of more. Lively demo, it's very fragile, it's not a proper instrument or anything, but let's try it. So it has two descriptors in the sliders, and I can do a text search if it works, like that. Crowd. This means that on the phone. So we were talking yesterday about this idea of finding a flower. I think a good idea is to use the similarity sets as a navigation for that. So I wrote here that if you, for example, I don't like any of this, but let's say I like one. Then there's let's say I find similar sounds to this one. Fill the thing again. And then this one now becomes the first one.
Can you lower the volume a bit?
Okay.
Thank you.
So let's go somewhere else. Let's say we go here. When we load similar sounds to this one, it's not super fast, depending on your connection, of course. It's not, as I'm not downloading the high quality sounds, it's downloading the OCCP views, so it can not be a lot of faster than this, I guess. So now this one is the main.
So on.
So you get the idea. I think it could be a good way to navigate this loop. Say, okay, I like this one, let's load similar sounds to the other one and continue navigating. And also, when I was doing PhD, also it was common to do things like a kind of a similarity curve or stuff like that. So it's a kind of algorithmic sort of a sequence. Anyway, so then what I do cool is to produce the same thing with our local events. So as I was mentioning yesterday, with sounds from people, it's actually quite difficult to make a music. I mean, it's very difficult to predict what will happen, right? So the easy way is to curate your own database of sounds, and you can use the same technology. So everything is now open source. Gaia and Cynthia are open source. So this one idea that we had, mainly through collaboration with Dana Chambo, who was doing a kind of live coding library on top of the FreeSound part. And then we got to do something together. When I was started here, we thought we would do another backend for the same library that would actually use your songs instead of FreeSound. So that we did with Owen and BA. Started prototyping a bit this idea. It's very, I would say it's quite fragile and new, but there is something, and it's kind of cutting out the required technology and putting it in a Python server, and then analyzing your library with Cynthia, loading it into a Gaia server, and then from SuperCollider through HTTP, just as you would interact with FreeSound, you interact with this. And I also have the same sort of interface for it. That's between last night and this morning, 30 minutes ago. So I know where it is. Oh, by the way, you didn't show the content of this. So there are these two things, which are the content-based service. And these things are pitch settings and pitch. So now.
So that's combining a text search with a...
No, that is not text search, and that is not working either. And the server breaks, so it's a new... It's a bit fragile, as I said, so...
Does it re-index? Do you re-index the library all the time? Say, like, someone uploads the library, they're uploading the FreeSound pack right now. Does it, because a lot of the search software, I have a lot of software that does similar things, but as I add, I always have to re-index the library to make the search times quicker. Does yours update all constantly? Does it?
So FreeSound itself does it. So,
does itself,
so
yeah, but does your...
And they have a system that is continuously
updating. Indexing, but yours updates to that, or
yeah,
just...
Yeah, my thing doesn't know anything.
Okay.
It's based a silly client that just asks for the stuff.
Okay.
And the website gives you what it is in the code.
Okay.
So this is the... I don't know what it was. So this should be the pitch here. And the pitch salience here.
So now we can hear low pitches.
Oh, wait, this is not the one that I was thinking. No, so I'm mixing that. This is the local one, that's where it's fast. And this is now spectral centroid and temporal centroid.
Okay.
So that one's spectral centroid, that one's temporal centroid. And actually maybe that one is not me around. Step motion to it very fast.
Less loud?
Yeah, sorry. It's difficult to adjust. Let's work the spectral centroid. Does not change a lot. Let's put this one.
The lower one is the spectral centroid?
No, the lower one is the temporal centroid.
That's where you're getting at.
Yeah, now you get the shit.
Okay, so I didn't hear the change to the spectral one.
No, so the spectral one has a... I thought it was from 0 to 1 because of the FreeSound website.
Okay.
So normally the trick here, the problem is to actually understand the distribution of the descriptors in the data. That's not trivial, normally it requires looking at the histogram. seeing where the stuff is. I don't have this for the local version. There is help in the FreeSound API or the distribution in the FreeSound database. There's some mismatch now between the one that we're using here and the one that's being used in FreeSound, so I didn't want someone. I was actually changing this 1 hour ago. The temporal center really dominates here, I think. The try to change spectra control. I know it's a bit more, but it's more like high frequencies. Right. So I think that was it. I think it's a very interesting direction, but at the same time, we hope that taking this technology out of FreeSound, but I worked there, I knew more or less it was more or less independent, but in the end, it was a bit more complicated than it should be. So my plan would be practically to write the thing, the Python thing at least. And then there's a question about Gaia, because as I said, it doesn't use any particular algorithm. So normally for simulated queries, you can use a KD-tree, some other K nearest neighbors algorithms that actually are quite fast. So even if you're not in C++, even if you're in Python, you can get actually quite fast. So there's a KD-tree in Sokratic, for example. And the other thing is the range queries and stuff like PCA. So it would be a matter of seeing how important are these things. And if they're not, I mean, if you can manage to do something acceptable, maybe you could read it to Python server altogether. And just supervisor and both. These are YAML files. We have Python supervisor for that. And eventually, we could do the same microphone thing with this. And that's it.
I have a small question. Is it possible to slice the sound from FreeSound with the API? Like, I want something specific, let's say I have a speech and I want just to get one, only the phonemes, only the plosives or something. You can just filter it within one same file. Yeah. No.
So there is a file you can get with the temporal evolution of the descriptors.
Yeah.
It's usually huge, it's too big. So No. And that's it should be at the indexing mode, I think it should be at some point I had to do about doing micro FreeSound. You've got everything into small pieces and
millions
and millions of sounds. But
Or maybe a free sound within a free sound. Like you download all the files, cut, for example, and then you only take one chop from each of them.
Should be able to do this for something.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, the press. Oh, perfect. Oh, no, my question is just stupid. Some of the sounds on free sound, they're in different categories. Some of them are like, the usage rights are slightly different for certain samples and stuff. If you look like Creative Commons, and then some of them have like some more restricted usages of the samples. Is there a way to, from your interface system, because like on FreeSound, when you can see, you can be like, all right, I could use this in everything. This sample limits me to using it a certain way. Can you see that information, the meta information through your interface quickly without having to go to see what the usage rights are per sample?
The license is one field of the API. So when we talk about interface, let's not talk about this thing because it just seems nothing.
Yeah.
But using the Sprocketed Quark, for example, or the any client of the API, it could say.
So you define it at the beginning without having to.
You could say, give me only some that are completely free.
Completely free. Okay.
So you can do that.
Okay. Maybe I was in the bathroom when I didn't. Did you talk about that in the beginning?
No, I didn't mention that.
Oh, you didn't? Because I came in the middle of your...
Well, I mentioned the several licenses that there are.
Right, in the beginning.
But
okay,
I was trying to go fast. So it was, at the beginning it was sampling plus, that was a pretty common license, it was obsolete. And then it was changed to these three, but there's still some sampling plus for people who never came back to the site and didn't want to change.
Okay.
But the CC0 is, you do whatever you want. There's a tradition where you do anything commercial, or you do anything public, you expect it to actually need the sound inside the offer, and there's no commercial.
I see.
You want to do something commercial.
Now, commercial is already
I don't know about you, it's always an issue with me, because you is a piece I do commercial or non-commercial? It's gonna be played. Someone's gonna pay.
You get paid for that, yeah.
So yeah.
It's probably commercial, but
it's very
I hate non-commercial licenses for art, honestly, because you never know whether it's gonna be commercial or not.
Exactly.
Well, the thing is, is if you're going to profit from it, you should contact this person and get a different license.
Yeah, but what if you use thousands of them? You cannot contact thousands of people.
Yes.
So my, I use FreeSound a lot. My search query is always CC0, CC attribution, and then I get.
You use it. You just pay back once.
Yeah.